We started talking in the last session about frequency and what frequency is. We talked about AC and DC and what the electrons do in AC versus what the electrons do in DC. So AC, alternating current, the electrons will change their direction of flow. They'll go from a positive to a negative, a positive to a negative. Where in DC, it's a flat line if you were to look at an oscilloscope where they're not changing their direction. So let's look at this AC, the alternating current, and see what's going on with those electrons. Now we had mentioned that there's something called frequency, or hertz, or cycles. If we look at this motor, if we look at the nameplate on the motor, we'll see on the nameplate HZ, that stands for hertz, and it says 60. That means this motor is designed to operate on a power system that's 115 volts with a frequency of 60 cycles. So what is this 60 cycles? What does that mean? Well, let's go back to the oscilloscope that we talked about when we look at an AC circuit. And if we look at the electrons, how the electrons will go from a north pole to a south pole, a north pole to a south pole. The frequency tells me how many times a second those electrons do that, how they go from a north pole to a south pole. So on a 60 cycle system, on a 60 cycle voltage system, the electrons will go from a north pole to a south pole, start going back to a north, 60 times per second. Well, is everything 60 cycles? No. What is it in Europe? In Europe, it's 50 cycles. So in Europe, their voltage is generated at 50 cycles per second. That means the electrons will go from a north pole to a south pole 50 times per second. Well, that doesn't occur as quickly as it does in the U.S. then, where we have 60 cycles. We have 10 more cycles per second than what they do in Europe. Well, is that a big deal? Does that have any impact on anything? Well, let's say that I have an electric clock, not a battery-operated clock, but an electric clock. This clock keeps perfect time, as does my wristwatch. Well, if I had one. Then now, at exactly 12 o'clock, the face on my electric clock is at 12 o'clock. I measure 60 minutes on my watch. Here in the U.S., at the end of 60 minutes, that clock will now show 1 o'clock. I take that very same clock to Europe. Remember, it's an electric clock, not a battery-operated clock, so it's plugged in. But in Europe, they have 50 cycles over there, and not 60 cycles. At exactly 12 o'clock, I measure 60 minutes. At the end of 60 minutes, that clock, when I run it on 50 cycles in Europe, now it says 12:50 instead of 1 o'clock. That's the impact of frequency. So if I were to operate this motor at a frequency less than 60 cycles, it will go slower than the speed that is shown on the nameplate. In fact, it will go 5/6 of the speed. 50 cycles divided by 60 cycle. 5/6 of that speed. Now, I can't operate this motor on 50 cycles, or I probably can't, because this motor isn't identified as 60/50 or plain 50. So what that tells me, because it doesn't show 50 cycles on the frequency, is that this motor has been tested on 60 cycle, 115 volts, and it doesn't overheat with the load that it's designed to operate. Now, because there's no 50 on there, it's telling me one of two things. It's telling me that it's not been tested on 50 cycle, or it has been tested on 50 cycle, but it overheated on 50 cycle. And so we can't use it on 60 and 50 cycle. So that's what that would mean. So now with this frequency, that can affect the speed of a motor. Now, when we talk about motors and we talk about motor speeds, now this motor indicates it's rated 1075 RPM. So when I have the proper voltage applied to this, and I have the proper load applied to this motor, it's going to operate at 1075 RPM on high speed. Now, you probably see some motors that are 825 RPM. Maybe you see some motors that are 1725 RPM, or some motors that are 3450 RPM. Those motors aren't changing their speed because of the frequency. Those motors are changing their speed because of the way that the winding is designed. You've probably heard of single pole contactors, two pole contactors, three pole contactors, four pole contactors. But motors can be identified in terms of numbers of poles as well. If we look at this motor, take a guess how many poles this motor is. This motor is a four-pole motor. One, two, three, four. If this motor only had that number of poles, it would be considered a two-pole motor. Maybe I have six coils in the motor. It would be called a six-pole motor. I could make this an eight-pole motor, a 16-pole motor, a 32, 128-pole motor. I can have any number of poles in this motor as long as it's divisible by two, because I always have to have pairs. Because motors work on the principles of magnetism, and with a magnet, I have a north pole and a south pole. When we looked at the oscilloscope on an AC cycle, those electrons went from a north pole to a south pole. On the motor, then, at an instant in time, I would have a north pole, a south pole, a north pole, and a south pole. But that changes. And it changes based upon frequency. So at an instant in time, I have a North Pole, a South Pole, a North Pole, and a South Pole. But then based upon my frequency, what was a north becomes a south, what was a south becomes a north, and so on. So with my frequency being 60 times a second, if this starts as a north, in 1/120th of a second, it becomes a south. Then in another 1/120th of a second, it becomes a north again. So that frequency will determine how quickly the polarity is changing on these coils. And then there is a rotor inside of this, and that rotor is being pushed and pulled by the magnetic force of those poles. That determines the speed. This slide shows more common numbers of poles that are seen in some of the motors that we work with. So it shows a 2-pole, a 4-pole, 6-pole, and an 8-pole. Now, next to the poles, we've got the middle column and the far right column. The middle column shows the speed of the motor when it doesn't have a load applied to the motor, when it's operating as a bare shafted motor, when it's operating on 60 cycles. And then the right-hand column shows when that very same motor is operating on 50 cycles. And you can see the speed in the right-hand column, when it's operating on 50 cycles, is 5/6 of the speed when we compare that to the 60-cycle speed. So let's look at that middle column. That's considered the no-load speed. There's no load on that motor when we operate it at that speed. You also hear it called the synchronous speed of the motor. And the motors that we're working with typically will never quite get to that speed, even when they operate under no load conditions. But now, when we look at that particular slide and compare it to this table, we'll see in this table that the far right column shows the typical speed that the motor achieves when it has a load on it. So a 4-pole motor, it could operate at 1725 RPM, could operate at 1650 RPM, somewhere in between the range that's shown in the right-hand column. A 6-pole motor, that's where our 1075 RPM motors are. So this particular motor is a 6-pole motor. If this were an 8-pole motor, it would probably show on the nameplate its RPM as 825. So now we see the importance of frequency and the impact that it has on the speed of a motor. If I were to operate a device on a frequency that it's not able to operate on, I'm probably going to burn that up. It'll create too much heat in that device, causing the insulation to melt, causing a direct short in that particular device. So frequency is an important component when we're looking at the performance of our devices. Appreciate you being here at the Packard Academy. Stay tuned for more in this series on basic electricity.